Hi there. In this tutorial, I'm going to show how I created this effect. So it may not be immediately obvious, but essentially this is particles appearing on these two mesh objects aligned with a video sequence or an image sequence. It could be video or an image sequence. It doesn't matter which, really. And then I've added a few other little effects just to make it a bit more interesting. So I could have used the color of the video and then it would have just been sort of pixelated version of it. And I've done a video about a still image like that. And you should find that in my channel. I made it quite a while ago. I may redo it. But what this one is really about is using the image sequence to influence where particles are created and how big they are and things like that. You may even recognize what video it is. It's one I did recently. So to begin with, let's just create a plane. I won't worry about the sphere. That's exactly the same. It's just that I UV unwrapped it as a sphere rather than as a plane. So we'll look from above. I'll just stretch it out a bit there and go into edit mode, U, and just project from view bounds. Next thing I'm going to do is add a cube. Now it doesn't have to be a cube, but that's just what I use as my particle. We'll call that cube particle. And I did this in cycles, so we'll stay in cycles and then we'll give a number of materials to our cube. So to start with, let's just give it a yellow material. This is just a style choice. You can do whatever you want and we'll make it yellow and make sure it's yellow in the viewport. But rather than simply a yellow material, I also came down to emission and pasted my yellow material into there. And you can see that's now a glowing yellow cube at the moment, and we'll set the background to black and I'll just turn the grid off and the floor off. So the whole cube is that color at the moment. So we'll go back to materials, we'll say new, and we'll copy the yellow material, click that little two, and we'll call this one green. And unsurprisingly, we'll just give that a green color, copy that and paste it down here. This is just for the viewport. It doesn't matter too much. And we'll now make a red material. And strictly, we should have six different materials if we want to color each face a different color, but I'm not going to worry too much about that today. This should be enough just to show what we're doing. I won't make it too dark a blue because it won't emit so much light otherwise. So then go into edit mode, face select mode, and we'll start assigning these different colors. Perhaps we'll go back to red on that one. So we've got a number of different faces with different colors on there. So back to our plane, we can now simply add particle system. I added about 20,000 particles. You need quite a few in order to pull out the detail in the video, but I set it to hair. Click advanced, and under source, I used faces and jittered, random order and even distribution, and then come down to rotation and turn that on. The reason for that is because we're gonna add some movement to the cube. So we'll do that now. So we're at frame one. I'm going to say I and select the rotation. We'll go to the end, rotate Z 720, so that's two rotations on Z, and then rotate Y 720 as well, and then I rotation. So if we press play, we can see it's rotating in a couple of axes there, and it's speeding up and slowing down, and I really want it just to be fairly linear. So I'm going to right click there on that little yellow marker and say interpolation mode linear. So there won't be any speeding up and slowing down, it just basically continues spinning, as you can see. So back to my plane. It's currently covered in sort of hairs. You can see them better there. Physics we'll leave at default. Then under render, we select object and we select our particle. Back under the rotation section, change that to normal and make sure you select object rotation here. Now when we press play, you can see all of our particles are rotating. They're basically just following the rotation of this object. So now we need to control where the particles are shown. So we come down to here under textures and we say new. It'll create a texture entry there and we click this little button to go to the texture editor. Make sure it says image or movie. If it doesn't, change it to that and select open. I used one of my jellyfish videos. So I selected all of the frames. It could equally well be an MPEG video or something like that, but I just used an image sequence and open. And you can see there's the video there. Click cyclic and auto refresh. Don't need alpha for this one, but if you do have a transparent background on your video, you may do. In order to not have the video repeating, which you may or may not want, but if you just want it once, under mapping here, we'll select clip. And you now see we've just got one version. And then we'll come to influence unselect general time and go to hair length and select that. And now all of a sudden you can see we have particles where there are bright things in the video. Now what you may need to do is play around with the contrast. If I turn the overlays off, we can see it a bit better, and I'll go to rendered view. So you can see there's a lot of blur and mess in there at the moment. So if I come down to here under colors, I ended up turning contrast up to 2. And you can see that cleaned it up quite a lot. Looks to me like we probably need to play with the size of our objects a little bit. So if I now go back to my particle system, and we can change the scale. So we'll go to 0.025, see what that looks like. And you can see, because essentially that's a higher resolution, we've got more particles that can be displayed. Might even go to 0.01 in this case. And you can now see we can render more detail, maybe 0.15. And although it's already a sort of light color just by default, I'm going to select the plane and just add a simple white material to it. There are no other light sources in this scene other than the particles themselves. And this is part of the reason that I'm rendering in cycles, because although I can make these particles glow in EV, the light from a mesh object or particle won't be reflected onto other mesh objects. You can still make a pretty decent show of it using blur and things like that, but in cycles it does. And you can actually see, even in this preview mode, that we've got this light shining. And if I press play and it rotates, cube obviously is rotating. Now we've got yellow and a certain amount of green light reflecting, and then red light over here. And you can also see that the image is animating, because obviously the video is moving as well. So it doesn't have to be the sort of video I've used. It could actually be real video. But obviously you may need to use the color ramp option under materials. So you may need to turn on this color ramp in order to play around with exactly what parts of the image contribute to particles. You're better off with quite a high contrast image for this. And then finally, let's just do a quick render of that and talk about a few little bits I did in compositing. I'll just turn the overlay on, switch my camera on. I'm going to do Alt R to remove the rotations on the camera, and then we'll just put that above and look through the camera and pull it back a bit. So we'll give that a quick render. So there's an initial render. It's still a little noisy and we'll address that, but we've got something to start with. So I've opened up a new window and we'll go to the compositor and we'll click here for use nodes. So obviously there is an issue with using cycles, that because of the nature of the render engine, it does produce noise. So you can see there's a lot of noise where the light is reflecting here. But there's a number of things we can do to deal with that, of course. So the first thing I'm going to do is click here under the view properties and we'll turn on denoising data here. So that adds an extra set of buttons down here that we'll be able to use. Basically provides more data. Then I'm going to go to the render settings. We don't need alpha, so I'll just go to RGB there, and we'll come up here and we'll click adaptive sampling. So this is just where Blender doesn't need to put so much effort, as it were, into the number of samples it applies. In other words, how much detail it works on in a particular area, it won't. And that allows for slightly improved render. So for example, there's nothing going on over here, so it really doesn't need to put as much work into this area as this area here. We're not going to use any of the default denoising because we're going to use a node to do that, but we could switch it on there. Under light paths, we don't really need to change anything there except turning off reflective and refractive caustics. Unless you're using things like glass or water and you want the little bright spots that come from reflections and refractions through those droplets, you really don't need those, and they do contribute to noise in scenes even that don't have those effects in them. And then under performance, I normally set it to 512 because I'm using the GPU. So we're still on 128 samples, which isn't very many, but let's see how that does. So the last one took 23 seconds, but we are rendering some more data this time. So this time it only took just under 17 seconds. So that's saving 6 seconds per frame, which is significant when you're doing an animation. Quality looks slightly improved perhaps, but not significantly. But we have now some data that will allow us to improve it still further. So I'm going to add a new node under filter called the denoise node. I'm just going to put it there. I'm going to break that there and just connect that into there. Then I'm going to take the noisy image output and put that into there. I'm also going to take the denoising normal and put that in there, and the denoising albedo and put that into there. You'll notice nothing happens at first, but if you look down here, in a moment you'll see it starts compositing. That's the only thing about the denoising node, is it does slow the final compositing down a little bit. So we've still got some artifacts, and some of that is caused by this HDR option up here. I found for me, removing that improved it slightly. And you'll see it'll composite again. So it's not completely removed it, but it's just smoothed it out slightly. And you can do it this way, or of course you can use the denoising options here. And there is a couple to choose from there, and then there's some advanced settings that you can use. One thing I would do for your animation is click this Use Animated Seed, because if you don't, you'll sometimes get a little bit of a sort of screen door effect where certain amounts of noise stay static while the image behind it appears to move. So you always want to click that really when you are doing an animation. It doesn't matter for still frames. I then just added under filter a glare filter and dropped that there. I set it to simple star, left it on medium, defaults here, but I set the mix down to -0.5. sort of reduce the amount of glare a little bit, and the threshold I set to 0.5 just to increase the objects that are affected by it. And then after it's finished compositing, you can see we've got some effect there, but as often is the case, you often need slightly different settings every time you make something like this. So I might come up on that mix a little bit. And I also found changing the denoising options here without clicking on use it during render from NLM to Open Image Denoise just gave a slightly finer image rather than the default NLM one. And then that's really all there is to it. So I hope you found that interesting. If you did, let me know. Don't forget, I've got a Facebook channel and a Twitter account. And now I have a Patreon account as well, if you're interested in that. And links to all of these will be below. And I'll see you in the next tutorial. Thanks a lot.